Hey guys, it has been a little bit since I've been on this channel. I'm on break, so I'm finally able to create and do things I love again. And so today I wanted to do a Bible study video. And I've been wanting to do this forever because this is really the reason why I started this channel, is to encourage people to be a light and to share my walk with Jesus. I'm really excited to dive into this Bible study. If you want to, you can follow along. Grab your Bible. I have mine right here. I'll be reading out of this. And if not, that's cool. Just listen. Or if you're not a believer, or you're kind of skeptical about this whole Jesus thing or God thing, I would encourage you just to listen, because you never know what you're gonna hear or what would resonate with you. Let's go ahead and jump right in. So I don't know about you, but I've been in a really weird season lately. I think everyone can relate with that, because this year has just been insane. It's been a crazy, crazy year. And I feel like it's like one of the first times that everyone can relate to that. Like, we're all in the same boat here. But I just wanted to talk about seasons, because I feel like even if you're not a believer, or if you're not walking with Jesus or have a relationship with God, like, everyone has seasons in their life. There are seasons where you're really excelling and doing great. There's seasons where you're pouring into other people. There's seasons where you feel like you're on top of the world. And then there's valleys where you are struggling and you don't know what to do. And especially for Christians, I feel like we have seasons where we feel like we're really pursuing Jesus and we're right in the center of God's will and where we're called to be. And then there's other times where it just feels like a whirlwind and it can feel like we're just so out of step. And a lot of that has to do with what's going on around us, and it has everything to do with what's going on within us. But for me, since all this happened, there was a time where I was really pursuing Jesus and seeking him every single day and actively seeking out God's best for my life. That was when I felt the most fulfilled and like God was really growing me. And then after a while, I just got really busy with nursing school and it was hard to make it a priority. It was hard to spend time in the word. And then all of these things are happening around you and it's hard not to feel discouraged. So really in this season, I have just really been craving to spend more time with God, because he's the only reason that we're able to sustain through this crazy, crazy season and crazy year. So with all that said, I just want to preface this by saying I'm not perfect. I'm not expecting you to be perfect. I just wanted to share this with you because it encouraged me, and I'm just hungry for God's word and ready for change. So today I'm going to be focusing in on John 15 and talking about Jesus and the fruit that we can produce if we are connected to our life source. So I'm using my ESV journaling Bible. You can follow along in whatever translation you have, but I also use an app called Enduring Word, and it has been so helpful in studying the Bible and really breaking things down and seeing what things mean and just getting more out of your Bible study. I really enjoy it. Okay, let's go ahead and jump right in. I'm just gonna start reading in John 15, 1. It says, "I am the true vine and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word that I've spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine and you're the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers, and the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you." Okay, so breaking that down more, in verse 2, it talks about how he takes away. It says, "Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away." And I thought that was really interesting. And so I looked it up in the Enduring Word, and it had a Greek translation from the word arrow, which actually means lifts up. And so this is saying that God essentially lifts us up for a better chance to bear fruit. So all throughout John 15, there's references to plants and to fruit and producing and harvesting and all of those things. I don't know if you're familiar with flowers or gardening or planting and maintaining healthy plants, but I always think of a rose bush when I think of this, because when you take care of a rose bush, you have to prune it. And that consists of taking off the parts of the plant that are dead or overgrown in hopes that new life will be sprung up and the plant can actually thrive and grow better. You prune so that the plant isn't using all of its nutrients on the dead parts and taking away from the healthy parts that can thrive. So in doing this, the plant is able to thrive and bloom and flourish and produce more than it ever could have. So I think about this in my own life, and ask the question, what is God putting in me and what does my life look like? As I reflect, I can see what God is putting in my life, and I don't know what that is for you, but in this season, I can tell there are fruits of the Spirit that I'm not producing, and there are fruits of the Spirit that I am producing, and I can feel Him working on the parts of my heart that maybe I haven't fully given over to Him yet, or things that I've given over to Him, but then I've slowly taken it back, and I'm not trusting Him anymore. It can be really challenging to give Him full control, but it is so, so worth it, and it's so beautiful to see the parts of me that He's slowly stripping away and changing, and I'm seeing new fruit that could never have been produced if I hadn't have given those things over to Him. So I encourage you to examine your heart, see what maybe you're holding on to a little bit too tightly, and give that over to God. I mean, there's no use in holding on to something that is actually hindering you and keeping you from growing. There is one theme that is so, so clear in this, and it is for maximum fruitfulness, pruning is essential. And just the discipline of saying, God, I want you to have every part of me, and I'm giving you those parts that is really hard to trust you in right now. And in this season when life is chaotic and I don't know what's next, I give you that. I trust you. I'm asking that you'll convict my heart and help me to see what's holding me back from a deeper connection with you and a relationship with you that is constantly producing fruit, the fruit that you desire. And I think when people think of discipline and pruning, it's obviously not easy. And so people just have this misconception that discipline is meant to harm us, and it's not. Discipline is so, so loving, especially when it's from God. It's not meant to harm us. It's not meant to send us in the wrong direction. It's actually meant to lovingly direct us into fruitful activity. So in verse 3, it says, "Already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you." How good is that? Already you are clean. Like, wow. In the Enduring Word app, it says that God's word is a cleansing agent. It condemns sin, inspires holiness, promotes growth, and reveals power for victory. When we know God's word and we're soaking up His promises, it's so much easier to see and be able to identify what is going to propel us into fruitful activity and what is actually going to hinder us, what's going to help us grow and what's not. And it just becomes so clear in the Bible and by the convicting of the Holy Spirit inside of us if we're saved, if something is productive or if it's harmful to us. And so knowing God's word and trusting in Him and really implementing that into your everyday routine is so essential in us knowing how to move forward and what steps to take and how we react to things and what we cling to and what our hope is. It's vital to our everyday life and situations because things are gonna come our way and we're not always gonna be prepared for what happened. I mean, I don't think anyone saw COVID coming. That was just way out of left field. And so if we're prepared and we come ready every single day saying, all right, like whatever happens, I know that I'm submitting to God. I know that God has my best in mind. I know that I'm going to be extending myself over to the Lord saying, God, make much of me, produce fruit in me. And I know that no matter what comes my way, I have your word hidden in my heart and that'll sustain me. That's enough. All right, moving right along, verses 4 and 5 say, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I'm the vine, you're the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. These are so key, people. So listen up. These verses basically tell us that this whole abiding thing is mutual. We aren't just praying to a God who never hears our prayers or who doesn't care or see every single thing that we're carrying or struggling with. God is involved in every detail of our lives, whether we acknowledge and see that or not. And He is abiding in us. All we have to do is choose to abide in Him and to remain in Him. How encouraging and beautiful is it to know that God sees you, God loves you, God knows you, and God abides in you? I mean, that is so encouraging to me on days where in my life, I don't feel seen. I don't necessarily feel the most loved, or I'm allowing things of the world to trickle into my brain and just send me on a spiral of negative thoughts, or Satan is really just like attacking me. Sometimes it's just really hard to believe those things, but knowing and reminding yourself all the time that God sees you, God loves you, God knows you, that He abides in you, that is so beautiful. And so then we have to ask the question, are we abiding in Christ? If Christ is already abiding in us and He is already chasing after us, are we chasing after Him? And one of the biggest indicators of if we're abiding in Christ or not is our decisions. Every decision that we make is an indicator of if we're abiding in Christ or not. We're not just robots that are programmed to follow commands, or our every little move is planned out and we don't have any say in anything. That is so not it. We have free will and God gave us the choice. And so we have to actively pursue that. And so if we're not actively pursuing Jesus, what are we pursuing? Every day with the choices we make and the words we say, we are either choosing life or we're choosing death, choosing to abide in Christ or not. And so a great question to ask, and one that I ask myself when I read this passage, is my life marked by the fruit of the Spirit? Is my life marked by love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control? Am I producing the fruits of the Spirit? I'm going to read verse 5 again. It says, I'm the vine, you're the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. So since abiding is a choice, we could totally live without submission to God, just like unbelievers and enemies of God do. But here's the kicker. We can't do anything of real eternal value without Jesus. And apart from him, we are so weak and so broken and so in need of a savior. It's only by realizing our need for him and just totally giving up everything and running towards him in reckless abandon, knowing that he can make so much out of our lives, of any situation or anything you may be walking through. And he can do so much in and through you, through your journey, through where you've been, and so many things in the future. God can use you, and it is so worth it to trust in him. Okay, I'm gonna read verses 6-11. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers, and the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. By this, my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. Okay, so going back to verse 6, without Jesus, without God, we are dead in our sin. We are lifeless. And also, just something to add, God knows who abides and who doesn't. And this can't be discerned by our outward estimation of someone's fruit in their life or what we perceive of somebody. We are not in a place to judge, but rather to love and spur each other along and to have God's best for them in mind. And so I just wanted to add that. But verse 9 is so sweet. I love it. It says, as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. And I love that we get this picture here of what love is, because true love is the perfect example that God the Father and Jesus is in our lives and what Jesus did for us. It's just crazy because Jesus loves us so much and we get the awesome privilege to choose to abide in him and experience life to the fullest. And Jesus is all about giving us true joy and true fulfillment in everything that he does. And he always has our best in mind. And let me make this clear. There's nothing that we can do to earn this. There's nothing we can do to work super hard, get to the top of the ladder, and then we're deserving. It is all freely given. And it's our choice to accept that and choose that and to follow him. It's not about earning. It's all about love and it's all about relationship. Okay, so reading 10-13. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. So then we can ask the question, well, how did Jesus love? How does Jesus love? And in the app Enduring Word, it says, Jesus loved without borders, selflessly, always serving, up close and personal, without measure, consistently, without regarding race, gender, sexuality, and anything else. And I don't know about you, but I am so grateful to be on the receiving end of that kind of perfect love. That just makes me want to love loud and set my agenda aside and love on people. God knows that our world needs a lot of that right now. So verse 14 and 15 say, you are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing, but I have called you friends, for all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. So friendship with Jesus can't be disconnected from obedience to his commands. It's not like Jesus is just your pal or your buddy and God is like your home dog. No, God is to be feared. But the cool thing is that he is God and he does want to be our friend. And that beautiful, beautiful friendship cannot be disconnected from obedience. Obedience always comes first. So verses 16 and 17 say, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should abide. So whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. And these things I command you so that you will love one another." He has appointed us. In Christ, you have a purpose. We all have a purpose. I don't know who needs to hear that today, but your life has purpose and God can make so much out of whatever your situation is and so much of you and your life right where you're at. You don't have to clean up to come to Jesus. Just come where you are and he will do more than you ever could have imagined. Even if you're in a season right now where you're totally lost or you never imagined you'd be here or go this far, he still has a plan for you. Even if you feel like you're too far gone, you're not. There's so much freedom that comes with surrender when we lay our lives down and trust in the God who made us and who knows us better than we know ourselves. It's so easy, and I am so guilty of this, but I get caught up in all the plans that I make for my life and, oh, like, what am I gonna do? What am I gonna accomplish? What are my plans for the day? What are my plans for my life? And so when those things don't happen, things don't add up like we thought they would, we're just blindsided. And it feels like our worlds have been shaken. And some crappy and unfair things happen in this world. And that is just the reality of the sinful, broken world that we live in. And so some of it is out of our control. And all that we can do is just trust that God can make much out of anything and out of where we are, and that he will grow us if we just submit to him. Even if you can't see it right now, maybe God is preparing you in this season for something that if you hadn't have gone through this, you never would have been able to do. If you hadn't spent this time in this season understanding and getting to know God more through that hurt, then you wouldn't be prepared for the amazing and beautiful things that God has for you in the next season. And so it sounds cliche, but there's a purpose in everything, and there is purpose in the waiting. And whatever season that you're in right now, be encouraged by the fact that your pruning is not wasted. I always say keep an eternal perspective, and I think you'll be surprised by what all God will do. Okay, so that is pretty much it in a nutshell. I mean, this passage is so good, and I encourage you to all go read through it and to spend some time in prayer and see what God is telling you. See what fruit maybe you're lacking, or parts of your life that you haven't given over, or even just take some time to journal and examine yourself and see where you're at, because a lot of times we get so caught up in going that we forget to step back and reflect. And sometimes we can be acting out of things that we don't even know that are hurting us or hindering us. And so I definitely encourage all of you to self-reflect. But I wanted to end on a quote. So it says, "The devil's main focus is to keep you away from the Bible so he can keep you ignorant of the truth." How is he doing? Wow, that was convicting. And I just wanted to end with that, because that quote got me really thinking about my life and what I'm letting the devil use as a foothold, what I'm not submitting to God. So I hope that you enjoy this video. I am by no means extra qualified to do this. I'm literally just bringing you on for a study that I did recently, and it meant a lot to me. And I thought that at least if it encouraged one person who is going through this crazy time, then it would be worth it. And so share with your friends if it encouraged you, and I plan to make a lot more of these in the future. So if you have a certain passage, a certain topic that you would want me to talk about, I would love to hear that in the comments. Go ahead and like this video if you enjoyed, share, subscribe if you haven't already. But I hope you guys were encouraged. I'm so thankful for all of you that do watch my videos. It means a lot. So I will see you guys in the next one. Bye.